Glucagon-like peptide was discovered in 1980s. It's a gut-derived peptide that is secreted primarily in response to glucose. The function of glucagon-like peptide is to stimulate insulin secretion. And because GLP-1 stimulates insulin secretion, we thought that we can use this peptide in treatment of diabetes. But the problem is that this peptide has a very short half-life, and the only way how we can use this peptide is by infusion. So these two features discourage us to use natural derived GLP-1. But with time, we developed other ways how we can potentiate the effect of GLP-1 molecules. Initially, we developed DPP inhibitors that can decrease the degradation of GLP-1, and by this they can increase the amount of GLP-1 molecules in the blood. And with time, we developed GLP-1 receptor agonists, which are synthetic analogs of GLP-1 but with longer half-life. So, GLP-1 receptor agonists, by stimulation of GLP-1 receptor, can cause increase in insulin secretion, which in turn will cause decrease in blood glucose level. And to explain it, we have to recall physiology of pancreatic beta cells. So, here we have pancreatic beta cell. Beta cells have GLUT1 transporter. This transporter provides transportation of glucose into the cell. Also, they have ATP sensitive potassium channels. And we have to know that in rest state, potassium channels are opened. So, because potassium is intracellular ion, which means that the concentration of potassium inside the cell is much higher than the concentration of potassium outside the cell. While potassium channels are opened, potassium constantly leaves cell. Also, beta cells have voltage-gated calcium channels. And in rest state, calcium channels are closed. So calcium, which is extracellular ion, in rest state, cannot enter into the cell. Also, beta cells have intracellular vesicles, and intracellular vesicles have already formed insulin and C-peptide. When glucose enters into the beta cell, glucose undergoes phosphorylation by glucokinase to glucose-6-phosphate. Glucose-6-phosphate undergoes glycolysis with subsequent degradation in Krebs cycle and electron transport chain that results in production of ATP molecules. ATP molecules activate ATP-sensitive potassium channels. With activation, potassium channels close. If potassium channels close, potassium begins to accumulate inside the cell. With increase in positively charged potassium ions, membrane potential increase. For example, from minus 70, membrane potential increase to minus 50. And the state when membrane potential becomes more positive, we call depolarization. And depolarization triggers activation of voltage-gated calcium channels. If calcium channels open, calcium by concentration gradient begin to enter into the cell. And increase in intracellular calcium triggers exocytosis of vesicle, with the release of insulin and C-peptide into the blood. The fate of C-peptide is rather prosaic. C-peptide comes to the kidneys, and kidneys excrete C-peptide from the organism into the urine. Insulin in the blood stimulates tissues to consume more glucose. And because glucose begins to come to the tissues, glucose level in the blood decreases. In addition to this, beta cells have GLP-1 receptor, which provides regulation of insulin secretion. Glucagon-like peptide 1 in the blood binds to GLP-1 receptor. With binding, receptor becomes activated. Activation of GLP-1 receptor stimulates closing of potassium channels and opening of calcium channels. As a result, more calcium molecules come to the cell. And with increase in intracellular calcium level, exocytosis of insulin increase. Interesting that the amount of glucagon-like peptide in the blood is controlled by a specific enzyme called dipeptidyl peptidase 4. This enzyme provides inactivation of glucagon-like peptide. In simple words, DPP4 destroys GLP-1 molecules. If we prescribe GLP-1 receptor agonists, they provide stimulation of GLP-1 receptor. This potentiates the effect of GLP-1 molecules and cause increase in intracellular calcium. And the higher the amount of intracellular calcium, the more active becomes the exocytosis of insulin. So the release of insulin and C-peptide into the blood increase. Increase in concentration of insulin in the blood stimulates tissues to consume more glucose, and thereby this will cause decrease in blood glucose level. And this glucose-lowering effect is exactly the reason why we use GLP-1 receptor agonists. In addition to this, the excretion of C-peptide increase. It's important because by excretion of C-peptide, we can monitor how much insulin beta cells secrete into the blood. So, the major effect of GLP-1 receptor agonist is by increasing stimulation of GLP-1 receptor to cause increase in insulin secretion. This will increase insulin sensitivity of tissues, which will cause increase in glucose uptake. But in addition to the major insulinotropic effect, GLP-1 receptor agonists also cause minor effects, which are related to their structural similarities with GLP-1 molecules. GLP-1 receptor agonists cause decrease in glucagon secretion that results in decrease in glucose production. They decrease appetite that cause weight loss, and also they delay gastric emptying that decrease the severity of postprandial hyperglycemia. As we see, GLP-1 receptor agonists are the most modern drugs in treatment of diabetes. According to American guidelines, GLP-1 receptor agonists are the second-line drugs in treatment of diabetes and established cardiovascular disease. According to European Society of Cardiology, GLP-1 receptor agonists, together with SGLT2 inhibitors, are considered the first-line drugs in patients with diabetes and cardiovascular pathology. So, the category of patients where we use them are patients with diabetes that have cardiovascular disease or have high risk of cardiovascular pathology. These drugs are one of the most efficient in treatment of diabetes. But the major problem is that it's a relatively expensive drug. Not everyone can afford them. The second problem is the route of administration. As we see, practically all of them are parenteral drugs, and patients require devices for injections. We can divide GLP-1 receptor agonists by the route of administration. Most of them require subcutaneous injections, and in turn they can be divided on short-acting and long-acting. The second group of GLP-1 receptor agonists are tablets. And for now, in pills, we have just semaglutide. The third group are fixed-dose combinations. It's GLP-1 receptor agonist with insulin. If we compare short-acting with long-acting provide a stronger reduction of blood glucose level. They cause modest reduction in postprandial hypoglycemia. Both short and long-acting reduce blood pressure and body weight. And the most common side effect of GLP-1 receptor agonist is nausea. So, as we already know, GLP-1 receptor agonists have multiple positive effects. They also are considered a drug of choice in case of diabetes and cardiovascular pathology, or in case of high risk of cardiovascular disease. And also, they cause weight loss. For now, most of GLP-1 receptor agonists require injections. And the only option in tablets is semaglutide. Increase in dosage of GLP-1 receptor agonists cause increase in their effect, which is logical. And also, we consider GLP-1 receptor agonists as safe drugs. Usually, they cause just gastrointestinal side effects as nausea or vomiting. And the risk of side effects increases with increase in dosage. As we see, GLP-1 receptor agonists are very similar to SGLT2 inhibitors based on their beneficial effects. These two classes of drugs are the first-line drugs for patients with diabetes and cardiovascular renal pathology. The reason why SGLT2 inhibitors are more popular is that SGLT2 inhibitors we take in tablets, and GLP-1 receptor agonists require injections, which is less favorable for patients. As we see from the guidelines, GLP-1 receptor agonists are very potent glucose-lowering agents, and also they have the highest efficiency in terms of weight loss, which is very nice for patients with diabetes type 2.